Good morning, Greg with Butter Suspension. Today we're going to do a little quick video on how to convert a bicycle from the proper wheel size, 29, to the new fashion wheel size, 29.27.5. It's called a mullet. Now, I don't understand why we call it a mullet. It's longer in the front and shorter in the back. But whatever, the industry does what it does. So for that, we're going to need a tire, smaller wheel, a link to change the geometry of the bike to accept the smaller wheel. And then we're also gonna install some other random accessories since the bike is here. Follow me, we're gonna have a little bicycle. You know, I'm just giving Jose some crap about going with the fashion industry as far as the wheel size, but mulleting, for a lot of people, is a great option. The wheelbase stays the same because from the center of the axle to the center of the axle, nothing changes. But the rear end of the bike, as far as the distance and the feel, the flickability, the maneuverability, it does change. So, and you know, everything in bikes, when you're trying stuff out, it's just an experiment. So he wanted to try it out. So we got him a wheel built up with the fancy. We're gonna put on a new tire, swap out the Ziggy Link, which changes the geometry of the bike so that it is ready for the smaller wheel size. And then we're also gonna do a couple other things. We can put on a new little fender to protect the linkage. And then he's got some new pedals, so we're gonna swap those out too. And then I get to keep these, because I'm a hoarder. So let's party. Tires have a direction, and most of the time, it'll tell you on the tire which direction it should go. See if this one has a little indicator. There it is. I don't know if you can zoom in on that. Direction goes that way. You can also, generally speaking, see the way it wants to go. A lot of times, the tread has kind of an arrow-ish shape to it. That also happens to match. It's not always that way. So I always just look for that and go with that. A third thing that you can tell, so this one has Kenda and Karma Pro on one side, and then it only has Kenda on this side. Almost always, if a tire company has extra lettering, it's on the drive side of the tire, which then tells you that's the rotating direction. Some people say that you should put this by the valve stem, and they're wrong, and that's okay. It's okay to be wrong, but you are wrong. I always put the label that tells you what the actual model of the tire. I line that up at the valve stem. It's just something that I've done for a long time. But also, on some tires, this will have all the information you need as far as max pressure, rim size, stuff like that. And so if you put it right next to the valve when you're pumping it up, the idea is that you can see what you're supposed to be doing when you're inflating it. So that's just kind of my rule of thumb. And then so I'll just line everything up. Start with one side. If you can do this without tools, that's usually the best way. But contrary to popular belief, you're not going to hurt anything if you use a plastic tire lever on a new tubeless tire. And I got soft suspension hands, so I'm just going to roll this over a little bit at a time. And then I will put most of the tire bead, the other side, on, but not all the way, because I got this big bottle of juice. So I want to give myself a little bit of room to put the sealant in. But I also don't want sealant going everywhere, so I'm going to roll over most of the bead. One other little tip. I will put the bead down in the middle of the rim. This part of the rim at the edge where the bead is, it's higher. And so if you're trying to get the bead over, but the whole thing is on that upper section, it's really hard to get it installed. If you put the bead down in the center, it drops down, which then allows the other side to flip over. So I got that most of the way. Now let's shake it up, there's stuff in here. Is this open? Oh yeah.
Actually, no, it's not.
What?
You have to remove something from, like, twist it off. But I smell it.
What? Oh, did you? Oh.
Yeah.
Double sealed.
Mm-hmm. So it doesn't dry.
Oh, I see. I'm the new guy. I don't know. I don't use this brand. There we go. That's actually smart. Keeps from making a mess.
Get an angle here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What do we got? So right now we're sitting at... Why? No ounces. How many? Okay, fine. Highly scientific. About that much. So right now all the goop is down at the bottom, and I'm gonna let this rotate. And now it won't dribble out while I'm trying to get this bead over. And you can see, because I put that in the middle of the rim, the channel, the rest of this I can just pop over by hand. You want to make sure it is on this side of the valve. If you put it here and you try and pump it up, nothing's going to happen. All the air is going to come out. So you want to make sure that is over on both sides. And we'll see what the compressor does here.
Sealant smells great.
Yeah, it's a nice flavor. Loud bang. Been doing this for a while. It's always nerve-wracking. So I'm running it up to 30 PSI. And then I'll just spin it. I'm just looking to make sure the bead... There's a little mold line right here. Just want to make sure that mold line's in the same spot all the way around. You can also just look at the actual tire. No tire is perfect, so don't expect perfection, but it should be pretty straight. And now the sealant's done its job. That's one down. Pardon the mess, by the way, it's a working bench. Ceram derailleur, click it out of the way. Pull the cassette off. You need a chain whip or a cassette vise grip. And then you need a cassette tool. Ugh. Oh, comes right off. Do a little wheel size comparo. So, much shorter, but also look at where the axles sit. See if you can get down. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you can see this axle also sits lower. And so that's why we're gonna put the Ziggy Link in, is to compensate for that. Because if you just put on a smaller wheel, which you can totally do, your bottom bracket has now dropped by about half this distance. Which, if you're not used to that, or if it's already a very low bottom bracket, you're gonna hit your pedals on everything. So the Ziggy Link changes that geometry, basically brings the bottom bracket back up to where they designed it to be, while still running the smaller tire. The other big benefit of going to a Mullet setup is your wheel's lighter. So two really big benefits from a lighter wheel. One is it's easier to spin up to speed. So like if you're accelerating out of a corner, if you're pedaling on something, it's less weight to spin up. The other thing is unsprung weight. So unsprung weight is anything that is basically below your shock or your fork. So like the lowers of your fork leg, your front wheel, that's unsprung weight. And in the rear end, unsprung weight is whatever isn't sitting above the rear shock. And so you can imagine if you have a heavier thing that's hitting a bump, it takes more effort to push that wheel out of the way to get up and over the obstacle. Whereas this is a lighter wheel, so it's gonna react faster, so your suspension will be more supple. It's a big thing in auto racing. They go for unsprung weight reduction anytime they can. Lighter wheels, lighter tires, lighter brakes, all that stuff. So, I'm a 220 pound person, so I don't really care about weight, but unsprung weight is very important. Jose keeps his stuff pretty clean, but I still just get all the shmoo off. These cassettes do not have to be on as tight as like a Shimano setup. If you tighten these down really, really, really tight, they stay put and they're very difficult to get off because this is not a removable lock ring. It's, you can see it's built in. There's threads on the inside. And actually if you spin this, you can see that it threads on at the back of the cassette, not at the lock ring. So you really want to make sure that when you're putting this on, it's snug, but not as tight as you would expect. Because it's not going anywhere. I like to get all the old dirt out. And this is pretty greasy, but I'll put a little fresh on the threads. And then down in here, I don't know how well you can see that. You can see there's a little plastic ring, and that plastic ring is what sits against this end of the free hub body. They generally don't get stuck here. They get stuck back here. So you just want a little grease right here. Keep everything from getting stuck. So I'll just pre-shmoo it right here. This is not like a perfect application. It's literally just applying it to all the surfaces to keep it from getting stuck. And you can see I found that where those teeth sit. Clunk. And then once those are in place, you hold it there. And you just tighten this down. And once it starts to get snug, that's good right there. It's not going anywhere. Set that aside. You can also see we've preloaded a 180 rotor. He'll have to bed in this new rotor a bit, but they're both pretty clean, so it should work out fine. I may end up pulling his pads off and buffing them out a little bit, but we'll see how it feels out of the gate. All right. Ziggy Ziggy. Can't remember on this one. Do we pull the shock off and then we can get to everything?
Yes.
I think so. And I think this one just barely. Oh yeah. Them folks at Fobidden are pretty smart. Even though it looks like it's real tight back here. Oh, that's how tight it is. Yeah, so we'll pull this off too. Beep, 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 beep. And it drops it back enough, just enough. A little bit more. Come on. There we go. There we go. Cool. So the reason why I did this, if you want to come on the other side, I can't get to that bolt. Now I can get to that bolt. I also need to get to that bolt because we're replacing this whole link. Stay right there for a second. Anytime I'm doing linkage work like this, I take one piece out, I set it aside in the order that I go, and then I go in the reverse order. It's the same thing as when I'm working on a shock that I have yet to disassemble. I'll take everything out in the exact order that I go. If I'm really worried about it, I'll take a bunch of pictures as I go. That way I can kind of see how everything lines up. These guys have really good technical diagrams online, so that also helps, and it's smart that they do that because not everything is intuitive on this stuff. All right, I'm gonna leave that there for a second because I want to pull this other one out while I have leverage.
Coming around.
Oh, that's right, that's the one that's not an Allen wrench. Is that threading out?
Spinning. No,
yeah,
it's
cool.
Spinning.
Good, good. It's because that one's just a bolt.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Weird.
Okay. Very weird. Okay. All right. Oh, dropping pieces. Okay. Here's what we're swapping. It's weird. It's not much. It's not much, but there is a difference. Let me see if I can run this through here. So these are lined up. It is so minimal.
Oh, wow.
The difference. But if you look on this left one, you can see. So this one, this straight edge is lined up on the bottom of this. And on the red one, you can see there's a gap there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you can catch that. So it just changes it a little bit, but it basically reorients the rear end to put the bottom bracket in the right spot for the smaller wheel. There's a couple hats that fell off here. And so we want to make sure we capture these. Anytime I'm doing suspension and linkage work, if it's relatively clean, I still go through and clean everything because dirt will mess stuff up, even though this is a mountain bike. Okay, so these also, we'll see if you can see that. These have a direction, but more specifically, they have a raised lip. And that lip is designed to sit against a bearing. So on these, there's a bearing back here on this front link. So this little lip is gonna sit against the inner race of the bearing. You can put this together with this that way. And now this whole plate is sitting against this link. And not only is it not gonna engage the bearing, it's gonna wear out this piece. And it's gonna add a bunch of wear to this piece. So you really wanna make sure that you put that raised lip against the bearing on these. So, secondarily, if you're gonna put this bolt inside a frame, Loctite is for the threads, not for the shaft. I see this really way too often where people get excited to put the new stuff on and they've heard they need to use Loctite. And so they'll put Loctite here. And what happens is you run it through the bore and it smears Loctite all over this shaft. And now the threads are Loctited like they should be. But also this shaft is now Loctited to the bearing and it is crazy difficult to get that apart. So you always want to make sure that you are only putting Loctite on the threaded portions. So what I do for that is I don't put Loctite on these threads for this type of application. I'll actually put Loctite here. So that way when I slide this through, there's no Loctite anywhere except where the threads meet the threads. And then when this gets threaded together, Loctite does its job, stays off of the shaft. So I'll actually Loctite on this side and I'll smear grease on the actual shaft of the bolt. So super important. Also, if you're gonna put Loctite on a surface, this should be clean, really clean. No grease, no dirt, no old Loctite. So I'm gonna try and take a bunch of this Loctite off, even though you can see this is kind of like a pre-applied. I still wanna kind of reset the clock. So we'll clean that up before we put it back together. So I'm gonna put the Loctite right here. Dribble, dribble. You don't have to go crazy. Yep. And then a little bit of shmoo of grease right here. Again, same thing. You don't want to get any of the threads. And I'll put it everywhere.
Set that one aside. Don't redo that. All right. So this is where it gets a little tricky. So I'm going to load up one of these washers. We'll see if it'll hold. So now you can see that's all ready to go. It's kind of tricky. And you'll notice the bolt's kind of in the way. So I'm gonna pull this out of the way. Have these guys stay put. I'll back it up. All I'm trying to do is just capture that one washer into the orange link. And then I'll take this one, slide it in, and I'll run it in until I feel the bolt pushing against it. And then should be able to tighten this down. I'm not gonna go full tight because I wanna lock everything down when all of the pieces are assembled, but I wanna make sure that it's snug and then also has good movement. And then we will go get the other setup. This bolt's pretty greased, so I'm gonna leave that the way it is, but I will pull the Loctite off this, just like the other one. They got that sticky icky. Okay, so same thing here. This bolt is going into this axle, and so I put the Loctite in here. I don't want Loctite going between a bolt and a bearing, unless the design calls for that. There are some, but it's very rare. You want to be able to move this stuff around. So, but these little jammers have shifted, so. One trick you can do on these, you can see this one's pretty pre-greased. This is just a spacer. I'll clean off the schmoo. But one of the best ways to get spacers like this to stay put while you're trying to put everything together is just grease the faces where it meets the bearing. And also, this is why I go through so many Q-tips. I'll get in here and clean off any dirt. And then I will not put that in my ear. But, just a little grease. And then if you stick it right here, it should stay put with the grease. Very nice.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll load this buddy here. The same thing too, you can kind of load this into this spacer. So you can see the spacer is held by the grease but also captured by the axle. But the axle needs to go into this link, so I'll just back it off a tiny bit. And then I'll move everything up into place until the axle pops where I want it. Then lift this up out of the way of the chainring, get it started. Come on, buddy. Oh, and then we're going to snug this up. I don't really get that flipped. But we're going to go online and get all the torque specs for these, like we do every time, because I don't memorize torque specs for stuff like this. Okay, so these are 14 newton meters, and then the shock bolts are 10 newton meters. So, get in on this one. Oh, nope, go the other way. Hold, please. What the? Go back. There we go. So we're gonna lock this one here. Hold. Come on. Clicky. And this one has the backside. There it is. Cool. And then we back it off deep in. I think are these? Those are fives.
And these appear to be titanium, right?
Those are steel.
Oh, steel.
Although, I know they're not titanium. I think they're just a very high quality stainless. Yeah. They're too heavy to be tie.
Sorry.
It's fine.
I mean, how does that? Is that buddy?
Yeah. So if I can get in here. Oh, the Loctite is hard to get into. Just a dribble. Everything's hidden. Okay, so this is the one time where I'm gonna break my rule. Because it's so hard to get in there, I'm going to put a little Loctite on the threads, and then I'm gonna wipe like the tops off, because I want to make sure nothing gets smeared. So you can see I got Loctite, but I'm gonna knock it off. That way it's down in the threads and it doesn't smear on. Remember that that one goes at the back. Okie dokie. Get this all loaded up. Maybe this one won't let us do this. Yep. That's right. Sorry. because this one wants to barely get started at the back. We'll allow this front end to move. Just needs to come down a little bit. Oh.
Sorry.
It's a tight tolerance. Come on, buddy. There we go. We had to pull the chain ring off to get this all configured, but now we got it. So the bolt is in. Run that one there. Notice I did not tighten it down. Same thing. This one I will not actually torque. But one thing I do, so right now there's play in the system. And so what I'll do is I know that when you sit on the bike, it's going to load it this way. So I'll pull this up to load the bolts. And then after this, I'll check torque. The reason why I do that is because of the play. You don't want the thing sagging down to torque your bolts. And then the rider goes to ride and then it can kind of lock into place. So I always preload it to make sure it's where we want it. And this one is 10 newton meters. Oh, well, luckily my hand is really good at 10. And is this gonna fit without the, oh, cool. Same thing. Always unwind your torquey wrench all the way. Okay, so that's in. Put the crank back on. Sometimes you gotta mess with stuff when you're gonna mess with stuff.
Just quickly, in case people run into the same issue, what happened?
So, to get the shock in, to get the bolt into the shock, the whole linkage has to clear for the bolt head to pass right here. You can see we scuffed the plastic cover, but it's actually, that's just a sticker. But to get that bolt in, I think something is just a little bit shorter when you combine the Ziggy Link with the Cascade Link. And even with the front shock bolt off, the whole thing doesn't move down enough to slide this bolt in. So what we saw was that the actual frame itself was hitting on the chainring, because Jose's a beast, so he's got a 32 tooth up front. But the 32 tooth would sit right there, so when we take the crank off, it allowed it to fall down just barely enough. I mean, literally we got like a millimeter out of the thing, but that's all we needed. So now we'll put the crank back on and finish with the rest of the job. Hey gang, so it's a week later because we needed to swap chain rings. Whenever you're doing stuff like this, you can't know everything. That's the one thing I tell everybody. I've known this a long time. You cannot know everything. And so it turns out on this frame, in this size, when you put on a Cascade Link and a Ziggy Link to go mullet, you cannot run a SRAM 32 tooth chainring. And all of that has to do with the profile of these teeth right here. The way that they protrude up through the chain for retention, and these are brilliant for retention, unfortunately they are taller than the normal chainring tooth, so it actually hits the frame right here, and it makes it so that the frame doesn't come all the way down so we can get the bolt in. So the reason why it's a week later is because we needed to order a chainring to finish the job. So here it is. Now we have a 30 tooth. Jose is no longer a beast. Sorry. We're going to get that mounted up, and then we'll be pretty much all done here. See if I can do this with the chain out the way. Chainring. Now you can see we have plenty of room. Lots of room there. So I'll snug this up with the regular wrench and then finish it off with a torque wrench. So many torques. Boom. Oh. Cool. Clearance, clearance.
Lots of room.
Yeah, if you see here, it might be a little hard to see, but every other tooth, it comes all the way through, and it's just enough in the 32 for it to hit the frame. Not really an issue while riding because you're sitting on the bike and the chainstay pulls up. But when you're trying to swap out the shock to go mullet, it didn't work out. So you learn something every day. I don't always trust the internet, but the internet helped on this one because it said in some instances, this frame and this size, you can't run a 32 tooth. So props to Fobidden for putting that info out there. I think we're all done. You now have a hockey haircut, Jose. Good job. Thanks for watching. As usual, tell your friends how much you love the channel because we love you and we want to love more of you. Like, subscribe, blah, blah, blah. We'll see you on the internet in 20 minutes.